So tonight I'm really excited because we're starting a series that's going to be trickled out throughout the summer. The next few weeks are going to be around the colors of hope, which is a devotional journal of LGBTQ plus IA Christians. If you are
not...
What a night. So I just want to welcome Melissa Guthrie and thank you for joining us and for agreeing to introduce us to this devotional series and connecting me to so many wonderful people that I've already started getting to know a little bit better around the country. Tonight, on the calendar, we had talked about the color green as one of these colors of hope, but Melissa is the editor of this devotional book and suggested that we begin actually with the introduction, and then we'll welcome her back at another time where she can do her chapter on the color green. But before we start, I'm going to play a video just to kind of set the tone. And then, but before I even do that, I would like to just take a second and give Melissa an opportunity to introduce herself, because I opened your bio on the Disciples Alliance Q website, and I wasn't quite sure what of your many accolades I should share with the group. So why don't you talk to us about who you want us to know you as?
Well, folks, it's good to be online with you. And I didn't remember that we would be spread out so many places. And that just reminds me that community really can happen across the miles. And so I'm glad to be here. My name's Melissa Guthrie, and my pronouns are she and her. And I live in Greensboro, North Carolina. I grew up in the Midwest in Iowa, and that's where my family still is. But I have kiddos, and I might have broccoli in my hair because the one-year-old insists on feeding herself. And so if you do see something on the screen, it's broccoli from that one-year-old. Goodness, I've served as the executive director and minister with Alliance Q, the Disciples LGBTQ plus Alliance, since 2019. And generally speaking, this ministry serves Christian Church Disciples of Christ, individuals and congregations. We also have a growing list of ecumenical partners and some interfaith partners as well. We support LGBTQ plus folks. You will not be surprised. Many of us have been hurt by churches and by people of faith. And so we journey with them, and then we journey with congregations to help them grow in their welcome and in their practice of social justice. So that's a really short synopsis. Mom is really my full-time job, and then the ministry. But I think being a parent is a ministry of itself. So I'm so glad to be here. Thanks, Michelle.
Thank you. And thank you for that introduction, and welcome, Diana. So let me get this party started here. And I'm hoping I'm clicking the right video. I had some technical difficulties earlier.
Baby blue staring in the window pane, just counting drops of rain, wondering if she's got the guts to take it. Running down her dreams in a dirty dress, now her heart's a mess, praying she will find a way to make it. So keep on climbing, though the ground might shake, just keep on the way. For a sign in the night, even like a lonely string of lights that'll burn just long enough for you to see it. The road's been long and lonely, and you feel like giving up. There's more to this than just the breath you breathe.
All right, Melissa,
floor
is yours.
Will you put the name and artist of that song in the chat? That was beautiful.
It was. I have a question. How'd they get up in those chairs?
I was looking at
I know that's not what you're going to talk about, Melissa, but go ahead.
It was the power of the Holy Spirit, actually.
That's right. I wondered if at the end, because they were speaking about on the way down, you can fly, if they were going to come off of the chairs and have, I don't know.
You know, they were going to, they just ran out of budget.
That's right. That was a beautiful song. Colors of Hope. Wow, I heard a lot of hope in that song. And so thank you, Michelle. I am a conversational person, and so I'll have questions for us tonight, as well as an overview of Colors of Hope, and I hope you'll participate. I didn't name it in my introduction, but I used to be a high school teacher, and so I'm really good at waiting and trusting that from the silence someone will share. But I see names on the screen. When you all talk out, Michelle, do you just kind of popcorn? Is that how you do it?
Yeah, we're trying to get better at raising our digital hand, or if we don't know how, at least waving at the screen so that you can call on us.
Yeah. Okay.
We don't have on each other.
Wonderful. So then a context question to get us started. How would you define hope? Or if you had paper and art supplies in front of you, how would you illustrate hope? How would you define hope, or how would you illustrate hope? Anatha?
This is my sign of hope, like optimism and looking forward to something positive will happen. And so that's initially, that's my response.
I think hope might be that no matter how bad things might seem at the moment, it's momentary and it's going to pass and it's going to get better and you're going to learn from it and be a better person because of it. Mm. And that's the wisest thing I'll probably say all day.
I'm writing it down, Rick.
I think for me, hope is this group and every day discovering more and more people who are open and loving and hopeful because that's contagious. So for me, hope is contagious.
We usually don't want things that are contagious.
So COVID was very hopeful.
And I guess I'd say visually, maybe a fountain or fireworks for hope.
Will you say more about that?
I don't know. It just comes from a central place and then comes up and spreads out and sprinkles out and gets bigger. It's just what popped into my mind.
If we had a lot of time, Desiree could paint a beautiful
picture. Oh, no. We don't have a lot of time.
You could do that in between all of your conversations. If you do, I'd love to see it.
Anyone else?
I think Tracy said something. She's mute.
I didn't hear that.
I know. I'm sorry. I just put it in the chat. I said, you just get right on that, Desiree.
I'll share that before the opportunity to work on Colors of Hope, I probably would have had a definition that was soft and flowery and delicate. Before my work on this project, I really think that hope seemed fragile and like the sun in the sky, which the sun's not fragile, but it was all of the beautiful, tender things. And I love, Desiree, that you said a fountain or fireworks. I've never heard that from anyone. And the fireworks is resonating with me because fireworks are not gentle and quiet, calm, right? Colors of Hope, and I'll bring us the full introduction. Colors of Hope suggests that hope is an act of resistance. So the book, the series, the reflections, it suggests that hope is an act of resistance. And I want to offer us an invocation that's in the book. I am sharing in the chat a file that is just for you. So for your use, it's a selection from the book. And you can click on that. It's a PDF file. Do you see it in the chat window? Okay. And you can follow along with me as I share some from Colors of Hope. We don't have time tonight, but even before the introduction, we offer a note about language. For example, we share why we chose to use LGBTQ+. We say something about the word from, because it was significant for us that this is not a book for LGBTQ+ people. It's for everybody. But it happens to be from these folks. And the invocation that you can follow along with, or you can get comfortable and receive the words, the blessing. It was composed by Tyler Heston. He previously served on the council for the organization I work with, and he is a youth minister and also doing PhD work. Tyler says, "Shine through us. God, who breathes life into each of our bodies, you speak creativity into chaos, and all that you make is good. We are made in your wonderful image, bearing your grace, your peace, your joy, your love. We are created by you, our creator, to go out and create, to make wholeness where things are fragmented, to sing harmony where things are out of tune, to fashion peace where there is strife, and incarnate love where there is hatred. Forgive us, God, for the places in which we struggle to embody our faith. Forgive us for the fragmented identities, the dissonance between us and you, the discord we cause with others, the discrimination we fail to end." As Jesus confronted people around him, "When they twisted your call, empower us to stretch our understanding, to resist the systems that do harm and dehumanize, to flip over tables of injustice that limit the fullness of life for everybody. Let us see the simplicity of your all-embracing love. God, who is present with all people, lead us and unite us in your spirit. She mends together things that are broken. Send us forward to share your radical love, a love that discriminates against no person, a love that celebrates the abundance of ways that we humans, your creation, move, love, and live. Hold us together and sustain our hope when we are despised for our difference, or when we don't know what to make of the difference of another. Shine through us, illuminating our rainbow colors, so that we, your people, form a mosaic made in your image, where beauty, hope, healing, and love color every corner. Amen." An introduction to Colors of Hope.
Very nice.
I wonder if anybody wants to share something from that invocation that resonated with you.
I really like toward the end, the shine through us, Desiree's fireworks again came to mind when you were reading that, shine through us, illuminating our rainbow colors, so that we, your people, form a mosaic made in your image. I love that. I think that resonates for me, the mosaic specifically, because it takes me back to, my childhood, where the talk of the melting pot was big. Now there's more of an appreciation of not so much an amalgamation, but a celebration of difference and being together, being different together. And a mosaic paints a better picture of that. And expresses appreciation for being different together. So that resonated with me.
I can't see the invocation, and really, I'm a slow listener, I guess. The flipping of the tables, I don't know what the reference of that was, because I can't reference it.
wasn't that when Jesus flipped over the table of the text folks? It's really going to Walmart and just, you know dumping on them.
I'll make sure that Michelle has the file to send out and share with folks so that whether or not you have a copy of the book moving forward, you'll have these words to revisit.
Roy had a comment.
When I began my ministry, my first church was in Dallas County, Texas. Out in the northeast corner of Dallas County at a little bitty train stop called Saxe. And there was a man in that church who was about 90, and I went out to see him to make a pastoral call, and he was plowing the ground in August with an old mule, and there were no moisture in the ground. There were cracks in the field that were big enough for a grown man to fall into. And as he plowed the ground, I thought, what a waste of time. And when he stopped, I went out to Uncle Bud Smith and I said, what keeps you going, Uncle Bud? And he looked at the field, at all those cracks, and he looked up at the sky and he said, he hopes me. He hopes me. I think of hope as, in spite of what it looks like, there's anticipation for a good outcome.
Roy, thank you so much for sharing that.
Hope gives you the confidence to see what doesn't exist, but still could. And it does it unfettered. Hope gives you the, hope gives you the opportunity to see things not as they are, but as they can be, and also points you in the direction to try and accomplish that. Thus the term, remain hopeful.
Tracy's got her hand up.
Well, I don't know if Jim will agree with me on this, but we just spent the 4th of July with my college roommate and her husband at their farm in near Washington, Georgia. And this year there were three people there. Well, two, this young couple, this woman and her partner were there, and this other young man who's gay were there for the long weekend. And when you were reading the invocation, I was thinking about how much fun they were and how just so full of color, like you're talking about in the poem. I mean, Jonathan, oh gosh, you know, when he was talking about his recent boyfriend who was a cheater and a liar, and you know, I was thinking to myself, it doesn't matter who you love, it happens to all of us. And just, you know, how open they were with us and how full of life they all were. And they felt comfortable around us. Otherwise, they wouldn't have opened up like they did. But we just had a great time because of who they are, right? And I think they probably, I don't know how comfortable they feel being themselves everywhere, but that would be hope, I think, is that each of us feel comfortable being who we are, wherever we are, right? Whether you're LGBTQI+. Did I get it right?
Yeah. Faith, or I'm sorry, not faith. Hope has no color. Hope is all colors.
Yeah, hope is every color. It's for everybody.
I think you all should just read the entire book, Colors of Hope. Tracy, you prompt me to turn to the introduction because it's titled, This is Who I Am. And I'll share it, but preface it with an invitation, not an assignment. But what if each of us took that prompt, this is who I am, and we wrote about who we are, or we spoke about who we are? Who are we? Why do we choose the things to, why did I tell you I'm a mom? Why did I tell you, what are the things that make us who we are? This is who I am. Alicia LaPerch uses the pronouns they, them, and it's not my preference to read at you. But Michelle, tell me, since the material was just shared tonight, does it make sense that I read the selections from the introduction? Or would we prefer to spend time with it for, take 5 minutes in silence and read?
I think you read.
Okay. All right. If you're following along, I'll let you know when I'm going to skip a few paragraphs so that we have more time for conversation.
And I did email it out just now, so if that's easier for some of you to open an email, you can do that.
Thank you, Michelle. Alicia LaPerch writes, what does hope look like in our changing landscape? What color is hope? Gilbert Baker created the original Pride flag in 1978 to spark courage in the LGBTQ+ community, offering a means of proclaiming, this is who I am. In a world where discrimination and hatred range from shame and dismissal to physical violence, it takes hope and courage for LGBTQ+ people to be out, to proclaim, this is who I am. Journalists and historians write that Baker was urged by Harvey Milk, the first openly gay person to be elected to public office in California, to devise a new symbol of pride. The original flag had 8 stripes. Pink stood for sexuality, red for life, orange for healing, yellow for sunlight, green for nature, turquoise for magic or art, blue for harmony or serenity, and purple for spirit. What theme would you assign to each color? How can we individually and collectively hope in color? Rick, I like how you said hope is all the colors. Yes, 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 it is. Hope is an act of resistance, challenging and dismantling systemic injustices that rob people of wholeness and wellness, that deprive us of hope. It resists the depression and despair that swirl within us and around us. To hope is to imagine and shape a new reality, a brighter future, a more just and inclusive world. Our goal for the book, by the way, was just that, just a small hope. That people read and learn and work together to imagine and shape a brighter future, a more just and inclusive world. At the top of page 2, the hope of our ancestors in the LGBTQ+ community carries us into the present moment. If it weren't for those who came before us, their struggles, their witness, their hope, we would not be where we are today. In the United States, we have equal marriage rights. An out gay man ran for president, and there are pride parades on the streets of some of the most unexpected towns. But we are far from fulfilling our hopes for justice and equity. Still, we must recognize that we are living in the hope of those who came before us. It is now our turn to hope in color, imagining and shaping that just future where the expansive love of God is embodied in every aspect of life. You might be wondering about these LGBTQ plus ancestors. Well, and if you're following along, there are some key words italicized. We'll talk about those. Marsha P. Johnson resisted the brutality of the police at Stonewall and became a queer icon. Sylvia Rivera, also involved in the riots at Stonewall, embodied the LGBTQ plus community's concept of chosen family in her bond with Marsha P. Johnson, saying that Johnson was like a mother. And Rivera sought to establish safe spaces for queer homeless youth. Gilbert Baker created a symbol to represent the great expanse of identities and individuals in the LGBTQ plus community and utilized art for activism. A Disciples of Christ church in Lynchburg, Virginia, stretched that pride flag across its church building. And I drove by it every day on my way to and from an internship my junior year of college at Liberty University. The public display of the pride flag stretched my view of the church, prompting me to realize I wasn't alone. I shared my story of self-awareness and affirmation with the pastor of that congregation years later. The minister wrote, "That's what the flag symbolizes to us, hope. We hoped the pride flag would remind people that they are never alone." Wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, hope. Before I continue with the introduction, I want to ask, from those words, and I'm putting them in the chat, which one do you connect with? You like it, or actually it makes you uncomfortable, or for whatever reason, wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, hope. Tom?
Well, the one that strikes me is share, because my mentor in a program through the University of the South, a program that's in the Episcopal Church, you know, called me one day and said, "I want you to go with me to this Unitarian church and meet this group." And it was a group of family members with their LGBTQT family members. And I happened to sit next to a man who's going through his transition of being transgender. And I had no inclination. I understood sexual orientation, you know, in people and things like that. But I had no understanding of transgender people. And I sat next to this transgender person, and he had such a love for his family, his children and his wife, and they all left because they couldn't understand what he was going through. But it became so real to me of understanding what he went through, because it brought, you know, a passion of love, regardless of what his situation was. Because he loved his family. He wanted to be who he was, or she. And it made me realize that, you know, there's, you know, love is a passion, you know, and when you have that passion, you can see things and it creates a hope. But the hope, when you share like that, you realize it's a process that's so long and so difficult. But just talking to people and understanding, because I didn't understand. He started crying. I got tears in my eyes. And, you know, because I started understanding what he was going through, because it was all about, you know, the love of his family, but he had to do what he really was. And it really opened my eyes. And, you know, I'm not in Fort Worth anymore, where this Unitarian church is, where they meet, but I get emails from them every week. And it's a group of wonderful people. And I saw the passion of love in there. I mean, that's the passion behind love is what really struck me.
Thanks, Tom.
You bet. But that was sharing.
Yeah. Rick?
Thank you. the two words that strike me are create and stretch. And I use the analogy, I'll be doomed to hell for this, but just the way that God created everything. Every day we have the chance to create our own reality, what we want the world to be in our eyes. As we do that, and our intention with it, and our heartfelt desires for that creation stretches out among everyone you know. It becomes just a giant rubber band wrapping people and bringing them in to you and, dare I say, your vision, but your belief. So I find create and stretch very, very important, but very descriptive. You know, I think you can't have one without the other.
Thanks, Rick.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask a question?
Mm-hmm.
Melissa, I never understood, and I haven't tried to Google it, but what are with the pronouns, she, her, them, they, what is that about? I never understood that. I've seen some people that I don't work with directly, but I've gotten emails and I see that, and I was a little bit confused. Can you explain that?
Yeah, I'll explain it briefly, and then I can drop in the chat or have Michelle share with you, with all of you, a link to some great resources that will explain and share much better than I can. In short, we have, most of us have been raised that there is a binary, that there is male and female. And some folks understand the divine to be non-gendered, for example. And then also, some individuals don't identify as male or female. And it is different from transgender, not I'm transitioning from one sex to another sex. Alicia, for example, and in the book, there is a description of pronouns, and Alicia describes more about pronouns, and then there's some links. But Alicia, and this is a very technical term, was assigned female at birth. And so medically, that's how I was assigned female at birth. And so very bluntly, like now we're talking about anatomy, right? So I was assigned female at birth. And I understand myself to be female. So my pronouns are she and her. Alicia does not understand themselves to be female nor male. And so they think that who we are is fluid, more or less. And so they, them pronouns, not claiming one binary or the other, helps them describe how they experience their gender. There's a really good, this was helpful for my mom, and it's linked in the book in a resource section. There's a gender bread person. So instead of gingerbread man, it is the gender bread person. And it's like LGBTQ 101. And so my mom, like when she saw that, she kind of got it. She's like, oh, and there's a link to that. If you all ever want more of the educational context, you know, Michelle can let me know and I can share those things with you.
Melissa, the word resist speaks to me. I think, you know, the whole world, I mean, we, every society, at a macro level, you know, resistance is connected to oppression, and oppressed people express their resistance, and deep within that resistance is hope. I mean, that's what they see as the end of the tunnel or the daylight during the nighttime. They hope for that. And, you know, coming from my Indian cultural background, where I was raised as a Christian among the dominant religion of Hinduism, Hinduism has such a nuanced approach to gender, because gods and goddesses coexist in Hinduism. There's male, there's female, there's androgyny among gods. And those are expressed in statues and paintings historically, thousands of years. And they have been celebrated, never condemned. And even in the history of the Maharajas and the kings, and there was quotations which were transsexual or bisexual, or their sexuality was in display and celebrated and worshiped in a way, you know. So coming from that background of that nuanced approach to identity, I'm always baffled by the American approach to this dilemma, the human condition, I call it, not a dilemma. why would there be such a debate or such an oppression of the other, of just because you don't belong in there? There's such a judgmental approach to sexuality and identity. Because such a complex, multi-layered identity, in not just sexuality. I mean, there's so much, so deep in terms of both physical and the psychological and mental and emotional and spiritual. We just don't get it in America. I mean, it has to be taught. And it has to be educated, it has to be engaged. I mean, and other cultures simply live in harmony with that. There's always pockets of resistance or debate or, you know, conflict in those societies also, in identity and gender, things like that. But by and large, society has learned to coexist and accept, even celebrate the differences in some cultures and some religions. When I see a statue of Lord Shiva with half of it is male and the half is female, children are looking at it from early, you know, childhood. And by the time they're adults, they have grown to accept that sort of a imbibing the differences in human nature, you know. So it's just a, those sort of things that really concerns me. And it, you know, so I had lunch with the Republican congressman from my district yesterday, and very interestingly, I mean, they have taken on LGBTQ as a social dysfunction, and that has to be dispelled at all levels of society in America. And he's a good Christian man. And in a way, I feel, you know, there's an inner conflict in our society deeper than I realize. And resistance is what that resist is very appealing to me, because it's something, a section of society deeply, you know, hopeful, but resisting of that oppressive nature that comes into the society. I mean, into their, you know, realm itself. So that's my take on resist for the world.
I saw you want to share, and I want to hold you, Tom, may I, for just a moment?
Oh, sure.
I want to say a little bit more about the book so that you have a full framework. And then, Tom, I want you to share. I've asked us from these words what resonated with you: wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, hope. The introduction continues to say that we began Colors of Hope as a podcast, and then it was transformed into this book. And I want to outline it for you so you know what to expect as you move forward. Each of those prompts: wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, hope, they have journal questions. And I really wanted the publisher to not limit it to journal questions. They are calls to action. So each chapter in the book, there are 9 chapters. Each of the 9 chapters has 2 or 3 calls to action, and they use those words. So there's wonder, and we are called to wonder. We are called to resist, and so on and so forth. The 9 chapters focus on each of the colors of the very first pride flag. And so the first chapter, I love that my first book started out with pink and sex. there is a scripture reference, and then the author, and there's a bio about all of the authors, and they have lots of different experiences, and they're of different ages and traditions. So the whole first chapter is about pink and sexuality. And then there are all of those calls to action: wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, hope. And so some folks spend 7 days with one chapter. So they spend 1 day with wonder, 1 day with resist, and so on and so forth. Others spend a day with one color and the questions. Some people have told me they've read the book straight through, right? And I say, I hope you do the work, because this is about the work that we're called to do as well. Red stands for life, orange for healing. I'm reminding us of what the themes are. Yellow for sunlight, green for nature, turquoise for magic or art, blue for harmony or serenity, and purple for spirit. And again, those are the themes that Gilbert Baker, the creator of the original Pride flag, gave to the colors. And so our authors might give some more history about that, or they'll tell their very own personal experience. And they often prompt us to say, what would you connect with the color pink? Or what do you connect with sexuality? And so on and so forth. The closing chapter to the book is the rainbow. And they're all my favorite chapters, but Marian Edmonds Allen takes all of these colors and all of the themes and brings it to a close. an invocation is offered, and I read that to us, and a benediction is offered as well. And so if those are not our practices in a context where we, you know, express our faith, we shaped the book this way so that we invite people into the journey, we engage the work through each of the colors, and then a benediction, we go out to do something about what we've read and what we've learned, we hope. And then there's a resource section as well. I wanted you to have that framework for the book so that however you all move forward, you know what to expect. I do think you have some guests, some of the authors, right, Michelle, will be joining you. And if scheduling works, I really hope that I'm back to talk to you about green and nature. But I wonder, Michelle, could I pause here and just see if folks want to ask me questions about the book, hearing this introduction to it, how we've shaped it, what it is?
Yeah, and Melissa, you need to go a little early tonight, right?
I can be on for about 10 more minutes.
Okay, so let's take this time to ask her other questions, and then we'll continue after Melissa has to get off, and I have a little bit more that will take tonight some time. But
Tom, will you share out while we think, while other folks think of their questions?
Yes, I just wanted to, since you mentioned me, I just wanted to show you something that I keep on my desk. I used to belong to a progressive Episcopal church until we got sued. But anyway, I keep this on my desk. It's called The Colors of Faith Ducky. And it explains all the colors of faith. But anyway, people wonder about it when they come into my house. What do you have that little duck on your desk for?
I love it.
Called The Color of Faith Ducky, and explains all the, but I don't want to take any more of your time.
Oh, no. That's lovely. That's
So Melissa, where do you see the whole issue of hope, colors of hope, collide or collude with faith?
Where do I see it collide or collude with faith?
Uh-huh. What's your reading of that in this country, especially?
How many weeks do we have left in this calendar year? Ooh, the country, the United States, we're in a very different place than when Colors of Hope was first published. We are working on volume 2, so I'm excited about that. And it's, this feels like an aside, but it's been really difficult to work on volume 2 because things have so drastically changed across the country with legislation harming individuals who are LGBTQ plus. I love that you say, where do colors of hope either, you said
collide or collude. Yeah.
Yes, collide or collude. And I was like, yes, it's both with faith. Personally, and so this is not necessarily the conclusion of all of the authors in the book, but I've spent a lot of time in my own religious and spiritual journey exploring faith and hope, and whether those are opposites, synonyms, parallels, how do they collide or collude? I didn't have those C words before, but hope and faith are incredibly messy and merged for me in my own spiritual journey. And the premise of the book with hope as resistance, I think that's where our country finds itself. I would hope, and it always feels strange to say hope so many times when I'm talking about the book, I would hope more people resist the oppressive systems that our country was built upon, Rick, like you say, and that we continue. So much needs to be dismantled and challenged and rebuilt. And so the United States, individual families, faith traditions, we have a lot to tear down. Some things cannot be rebuilt and we need to start over. But yet your question is very thought-provoking for me. And I said a few things, but I really want to think on that more and spend time with those two C words that you gave me.
What brought you to this entire path?
To the book?
The book, not only the book, but yes, but the entire, how your life came into this position. Yeah. By the book, by the way, I love the irony is that it's about color, but the PDF is in black and white.
Don't tell the publisher that I sent you all that file. I literally...
your secret is safe with me.
Extracted pages.
That's great. I'm looking forward to reading them.
Well, and that's interesting that you bring up the black and white. When I was sent the cover, first of all, I do want to respond to your question about what brought me to where I am. The publisher didn't want to have a rainbow on the cover because they thought, and they're right, that fewer people would buy it. So those folks who were not quite fully inclusive, they wouldn't pick it up. And I resisted that. I said, if you want this book about the first pride flag, like the cover is going to have the rainbow. And then we went back and forth. Should the word colors be in color or should the word hope be in color? And our invitation is that our hope is colorful, right? So that's where we landed.
Yeah, all right.
My journey, gosh. Growing up in Iowa, I was a part of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America. And I'm going to say church was important to my parents. And that's different from faith I've learned over the years. I was involved in my church because I had adults at that church who cared about me. I went to college and studied communications and religion. And then for me, living out my values and what's important to me in my faith, it's often been outside of the institutional Christian church. So I did Teach for America and I was a teacher. Some of you might know this reference, Dangerous Minds with Michelle Pfeiffer. Anybody remember that old movie? I wanted to be her. Like I wanted, here's this farm kid from Iowa, right? Like I wanted to be Michelle Pfeiffer. I wasn't Michelle Pfeiffer. They didn't send me to an inner city. I was sent to rural North Carolina. Teach for America is similar to like a United States Peace Corps program. I didn't get to choose where I went. I was told you're going to North Carolina and I've been here ever since. So I've been here for 20 years. I was a therapeutic foster parent because I saw so many young people who didn't have caring adults. I went to seminary. I thought when I went to seminary that I would be too liberal for the school. And I learned that I didn't know what liberal meant. So that's a part of my journey too. I continue to ask what hope is and what faith is, you know? So Anantha, your question, because I don't yet have my answer fully for the question, that's why I do what I do and where I'm at. I've always served or worked with people, groups who are marginalized or different. Because I can't not do that. My son has autism and some other diagnoses and has experienced a lot of challenges because of those differences. I am a member of the LGBTQ community, you know, so I'm queer. I can't not explore and work on these things.
Well, don't you find that hope is actually, I'm sorry, excuse me, Hope is is a fluid thing. You hope for this. And as this becomes achieved or is moving along, your hope moves on to, okay, we got this. Now let's hope for this. So hope is something I think that is never a solid thing.
So. I agree. And I would say, and I don't even feel like it's a confession, but as the editor of Colors of Hope, there are times I don't have hope.
See that?
I don't feel hopeful and so for me, hope as resistance is part of that. And it's, you know, if I get a chance to write about this, I would love to. I think the hope of others is what sustains us too. And so on a day that a person that I am not hopeful, or that what I have hoped for has will never come to be, right? So instead of achieving it and moving on to the next hope, it's actually destroyed. It is the hope of someone else that carries us.
And that's sometimes all you need.
Can I ask you a question, Melissa? You say queer. When I hear that word, it hurts my heart.
Okay.
But I don't know, because to me, queer is like odd or different, you know? And to me, we're all the same. So when I hear the word queer, it hurts me inside. I don't like to hear that word, because to me, it's like, one of my clients, when I asked him what ethnicity he was, he said other. And that hurt my heart, because I thought, you're not an other. What does that mean? And what he meant, he was half Black, half white. But I just thought, oh my gosh, I find that word so offensive, because I wouldn't like to be referred to as an other. What does that mean I am, you know? So that's how I kind of feel about that word queer. So I don't know if it's just me, because I'm older, but, and because of my perspective that it's all about love, we're all the same, you know? So anyway, and I bought these sunglasses. I thought they were cool. Can you see those?
These are cool. Yeah, I would say that there's a lot of history loaded with the word queer.
Yeah.
And that culturally things are shifting. And even in religious context, many folks are reclaiming what queer can mean. And it's actually very affirming and celebratory.
Oh, okay.
And so for me, it's two things. Queer is unique and, you know, not settling for a norm or a binary, those kinds of things. And then also, very bluntly, I'm a blunt, transparent person. Because there's an alphabet soup, LGBTQIA+, and the letters keep growing and changing, right? It's easier for me to say generally I'm queer, and then like when I get to know someone, because, and I'm like, you know, do we tell people what's in our pants, or do we, you know, talk about our home lives and our relationships and all of that? We do so when we have bonded or connected with folks. I would describe myself as pansexual, for example. There's not a P in the LGBTQ plus. Pansexual, if you haven't heard of this descriptor, is I might be sexually attracted to or emotionally attracted to any person, right? So it might be a man, it might be a woman, it might be a person who doesn't think they are male or female. For me, that would be how I describe my queerness, if it had a specific label under the umbrella of queer.
And actually, when I think about it, I remember when I was in high school, which was many, many decades ago, when they used that word, it was usually a guy putting down another guy. And so there, I think that's what's triggering in my head that makes my heart hurt, you know, is the way that was used back in high school for me. But thanks for the explanation.
Maybe one more question before I regret I need to sign off, but as mom, right, that other big hat. And I hope I get to come back. Michelle has my contact information.
Love to come back.
Yeah. Jim Hartley, I see you. Yeah,
I just wonder, what is it? Why do so many people fear or dislike the LGBTQ people? What harm are LGBT people doing to so much of the population that makes them pass these laws and get upset? I don't understand the why of that.
This is recorded, right, Michelle? Can we just, you know, pull that out and just share that everywhere, Jim? No. Right? Like, that's the question. That's a good question.
By tomorrow, we'll have this up on the up on our YouTube channel.
But Jim, my work begs that question of people. You know, your group's name. Before I even spoke with any of you at, you know, this spring, when I briefly learned about Ecclesia, I was drawn to you all because of that descriptor, and your shirts are really cool. Right? So.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've enjoyed spending time with you. I do feel like I talked at you more than what my preference is. But I hope you have a frame of what Colors of Hope is. I hope you want to pick up the book, just because, not because my name's on the cover, the stories that these authors share, and then the questions that are posed to us. I say this, and it's kind of on the back of the book. We want the book to comfort you and to challenge you. Right? So it says, we hope Colors of Hope will both settle and agitate your soul. So we want you to be uncomfortable, so that you grow a little bit.
Nice. Rachel?
Thank you so much.
I just wanted to say thank you. I jumped on late, so I didn't get to fully see everything and hear everything. But what I have heard, I greatly appreciated. And while I was sitting here, I actually downloaded the book, so that I could go ahead and jump into it after we're done. You touched on a lot of really good topics just in the last, I jumped on, I think at 4:30. So in the last 45 minutes. So I really do hope that you do come back and talk some more, because like just from what I've heard, it was wonderful. Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Melissa, before you leave, Mulvaney, jump in and tell her that just that short, very short story about the people who were against gays, and then when they found out that they knew some. Tell her that story.
Melissa, I hope we could come back, because I'd really like to have a longer discussion on this concept of doing different together rather than doing different apart. And what Tracy was referring to is that they did a survey of people's views around LGBTQ, and that 95% of the people who agreed with it had a family member or friend who were among that community, and 95% of those people who didn't agree with that did not have a family member or friend who was part of it. And what that leads me to believe is that somehow unity is one of the solutions here, by having these different people together rather than separate. It's not to force it. It's not to do it through your congregation. It's not, you know, we now have the no longer United Methodist Church over this issue. And if the Methodists couldn't figure out how to do it together, there's got to be a way. So anyway, when you come back, I hope we can have a broader discussion over this concept of how can we do different together as a solution to some of these differences we have.
I look forward to that. Michelle has my contact information, and I look forward to more dialogue with you all, and enjoy the other authors who will be spending some time with you.
And Melissa, you're welcome to come on anytime. We meet the same time, same station every week. And certainly these next coming up weeks, when we have Alan Harris here next week talking about purple and spirit, And the week after is Brendan Boone doing Blue with Harmony and Serenity. And then we have Marian Edmonds Allen coming in August doing the Rainbow, Fearfully and Wonderfully Made. And we will find a place for you in there somewhere, I'm sure. So we will definitely get you back to do green and nature, and also maybe yet another one on doing different together. So
I would love it.
But you're welcome to come on any time.
Yes, yes. I want to say Brendan was my pastor many years ago, and it is just irony how he got involved with this project. So it was really neat to have to work with my pastor all these years later. And Marian is, I want to be Marian when I grow up. Also, she's one of the most beautiful souls I've ever met. So there's a couple teasers for your next guest, but thanks again, y'all. And we'll be in touch.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Here.
Does anybody want to, that didn't get to the words in the chat that she shared, wonder, resist, embody, create, stretch, share, and hope. Did everybody who wanted to get a chance to share the words that resonated for them out of those words? Ron John looks like he's sitting up. There he goes.
Yeah. Sorry, I was late joining, but the word that resonates for me is wonder, because there's a very cultural aspect to all of this as well. And having grown up with it, I wonder, and I go back to exactly what Jim asked, because growing up, there was an acceptance for a portion of the LGBTQ community. And Anantha knows what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And they actually, you know, supported them. But at the same time, a certain portion of the LGBTQ community were absolutely frowned on. And I wonder, what is it that causes that to happen? Right? I have the same struggles that Jim has. You know, what is it that somebody did that you have to hate them that much, right?
Remember, people are afraid of things that are different.
Yeah. Well, you know, which leads me to believe that what you don't know is what you hate.
Yes, absolutely.
And it goes back to what Jim was talking, you know, Jim Mulvaney was talking about, right? The 95% that weren't in agreement didn't know about it, right? And to understand it enough so. But anyway, the other thing I was going to suggest is at some point we should probably invite our friend Raiz Puya, who is the founder of A World Without Hate. I would ask everybody to go look at his website. He has a very interesting story. He was a victim of 9/11, believe it or not. But his life's journey is phenomenal. And I would be more than happy to invite him to come join us someday.
Can you put his name in the chat?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. And I'm going to look him up.
Connect us in a three-way email, and we'll look at getting him on with the next round of stuff. So that's really exciting. Thank you for that. Some of you know my own story or part of it that I shared about my time at Texas Christian University. I was, I think I was probably a sophomore. So for me, that would have been 18. I started college at 17. But 18, 19 years old was my first experience with coming out day. And on a college campus, coming out day wasn't just, you know, a few people with rainbow flags and their cars passing by or something, you know, put in their email signature at work. on a college campus, it was literally the entire university campus was plastered with all kinds of people's form of resistance of the systems that were oppressing them. They were also, looking at my words here, they were also embodying that because so many of them, that was their, that was another, like that church that stretched the pride flag out across the entire church building as a symbol of hope and letting them know that you're not alone, and that we are here, we love you, period. You know, that for a lot of students at TCU, Pride Day, National Coming Out Day was a big deal for them because many of them had never talked to their families about their identity or their attraction. And so they were needing that solidarity. They needed allies. And that was a way of hopefully gaining that. And at that age, for me, I was at a place that I felt that if that was who they were and that's what they needed to do, that was their business. But to have pride, I can't think of another word other than paraphernalia, but the visuals and the words and the rainbows and everything that were plastered all over campus and sidewalk chalked everywhere at my place in my faith journey and in my age and a limited life experience, I was thoroughly offended. And so people that say the LGBTQ community has commandeered the rainbow flag and that was God's promise to us that he would never again destroy his people, and that was part of that Noah story, that's still a symbol of hope for all people, not just Christians or not just non-LGBTQ or not just LGBTQ. And so that day on campus, I was offended is the only word I can come up with, because at the time I thought, well, that's fine. That's you. You do your thing. You do your thing. I do my thing. You don't have to throw it in my face. Now, 35 years later and lots of life experience later, I obviously see the difference. And so the words for me, the day that happened, I was resisting that. Now I recognize it as of stretch. So for me, the word stretch is the word that resonates with me in hindsight, my 2020 of being able to realize that as a Christian, my call is to love them and to stand in solidarity when necessary against anything that is oppressive. And so my position on resist has been changed 180 degrees, and stretch is certainly what has happened to me over the course of my life and my own personal experiences. And so that gives me hope that I can, that tomorrow and that the next years of my life I will continue to grow. My hope is that I will continue to grow. So there were a few things I wanted to say before we closed, and I had one more quick song, but I realized we're out of time. So I'm going to say a quick prayer. I'm going to read for you a prayer that's from the Black Rock prayer book, Black Rock Native American prayer book, and then I'll play the song and you feel free. If you need to, you can jump off after. And if you would like to discuss more, those of us in Ecclesia here in Greenville in the very first year had a transgender friend who came and gave us a little bit of education about everything regarding labels and all of that. So Diana, I would invite you for sure, stay on after for the after party, and I'd be happy to share what I know about that as well. All right, let us pray. Eternal Spirit, who sees and loves those who often are unseen and unloved by others, we lift up to you all those who may be carrying heavy loads, those who have brought their losses and emptiness to this moment, those held down by addiction or threatened by violence, those who suffer in mind and body, those who feel unloved and unwelcome. May they find us in your hospitality with no agenda of our own except to welcome and listen, offering a cool breeze on a hot day. You are the God who is simple, direct, clear with us and for us. You have committed yourself to us. You have said yes to us in creation, yes to us in our birth, yes to us in our baptism, yes to us in our awakening this day. Amen.
You know, and interesting about that tune, the first time I heard it, they'd used it in a Chevy commercial. It was in a commercial for Chevy trucks. And then it started meaning everything else.
Certainly resonated with a lot of people, didn't it?
It did. And I think, and in light of our discussion today, I think it takes on a whole new meaning.
Thank you for your help with the music for tonight, Rick. That was good.
It's why I'm here.
So, Diana, we'll start with you. We'll go back to your question, too, about the word queer. I remember when I was in high school in the late 1980s, that word was, like you said, it was used in a derogatory manner. I think it's, and Rachel can speak to this too, but as Melissa, I think, alluded to, it's in a lot of ways, it's actually become a more generic term. So especially if people are looking in terms of the LGBTQ community as a whole and as in solidarity too, it's more of a positive thing for them. To say almost like instead of the binary of my brother, my sister, it's my queer folk because especially if they don't know somebody well enough, they're not going to go into what their particular, like she said, the pan that I've heard that one other time, but I didn't really know a lot about that. But when we had a neighbor friend of Jim and Tracy's out here in Greenville that is, and I'll email you a link to her TED Talk. So she did a TED Talk. She is an activist now, but Jamie was born Jim. And a very fascinating story that she'll share in her TED Talk. I think she tells her that part of her story in a TED Talk. But she came over to the house one day, and Robert and a handful of us that were kind of this early group of Ecclesia gathering. I don't remember, Sue and Greg, were you there too? So we came and sat around Jim and Tracy's kitchen table, and Jamie tried to help us understand. First, I wish I had the visual, but basically think of three categories. You have a category of identity, which, right, is more of my spirit, I identify as this. That's where a lot of the pronouns piece comes into play now. And that's out of respect as well, to be able to speak to someone using pronouns out of respect for what they feel, especially if it is a non-binary pronoun like they, them. We have a lot of parents right now dealing with that. We have a lot of parents that I've, and Jim and a handful of us have come across in just the last few months, that whose children are trans. Or they are, they identify as non-binary, and that is a whole other new thing for people to wrap their head around and to talk about this child that maybe was their daughter, and they've always referred to her all these years, and now her wants to be they, them, and even in the plural, right?
That's so confusing.
It is very, it's hard to get our English language brains to wrap around that. But there's identity, there is biology, and then there is attraction or sexual preference. So they're somewhat, for each person, those, just because they identify as one, they may still be like their attraction, like they may be biologically female, they may be attracted to another female, but identify as a male. I like my friend Kate. So I have a friend who is, her name is Kate, and she told me, she's, Michelle, I have always, from as early on of my life as I can remember, I have always felt like I was a boy stuck in a girl's body. But at birth, she was assigned this gender of female because she had sexual organs, at least more so sexual organs of a female. And so her biological body is female. But her identity is male and always has been male. She would be called a lesbian in our society because she is married to another woman, but her attraction to a woman, then you have to say, well, she's a lesbian because they have the same biology, but Kate's identity is a man. And so to her, it's a heterosexual relationship. The others that were on in that conversation, Sue, Jim, and Rick, whoever was there, feel free to chime in. But that explanation of biology, identity, and attraction or sexual preference really helped me to realize that it's just much more than just who you're attracted to.
Okay. Which I mean, and it's true. There's so much more to it. And her calling herself queer did fit. Like another one would be asexuality, and you could be asexual, and you can be gay asexual, you can be a lesbian asexual. I mean that, like, you can be heterosexual and be asexual. There's such a wide range now, because so many people realize that, okay, being a lesbian, being a gay man, being heterosexual sometimes just isn't the only box for you. We don't fit in boxes. We are a color of rainbows. And that's why the rainbow fits so well, because nobody is really the same, but we like to have these things to help identify, like, I don't want to be alone. You don't want to feel alone. And for so long in this community, if you don't know anyone else, if you don't know anybody else feels the way you feel, if you didn't know any other people that were gay, you felt alone. And that's why there's such a high rate of suicide in the community, because there are children out there who are being told that it's wrong. They're being told that, you know, you'll grow out of it. They don't realize that there's a community out there. And so that's what this is to be that community and allow us to have the freedom to be who you are, no matter what your gender is, what your preference is. It doesn't matter. And so queer can encompass all of that and allow you to be like, you're different. We're all different, but we all accept that difference.
I always like when someone would say, well, have you tried not being gay?
Yeah.
I've heard that one. I've heard that, and I've heard that I would grow out of it. That was one that I got a lot. You'll grow out of it.
Yeah, no.
It's 23 years later. I haven't grown out of it.
See?
I have two nephews that we could tell they were going to be gay, but my brother and then my sister, because they both had sons that were both gay, but they were both devout Catholics. And because of their religious upbringing, it was no, not acceptable. No, can't think about it. The older nephew, he was more in the closet about it. I think he was just so afraid because his parents were so strict. And then my other nephew, Mikey, he didn't care. He was like, Aunt Diana, your eyeshadow, this would be better, and this and that. But it was like I told my brother Bobby, because they were just thinking he was confused or something, or I don't know what they were thinking, but I said, if he can't have you guys, his parents, to be a safe place and to love him, I mean, gosh, the world is so tough as it is. So long story short, both my brother with his son and my sister with her son eventually got over it, because it didn't matter. That was their son. that was their child, you know? And that's why I always say it goes back to love, you know? And really, I'm just like, I don't know the terms. I'm just kind of old school, and I just go to work, come back. I don't watch the news. It's too negative. So I'm not up to date with all the latest terms. So I apologize for that. I just don't know.
And there's no way of keeping up with all the latest terms. I'm learning constantly. My niece, like, she's come out as non-binary. Her and I talk about things. My best friend just came out as asexual a couple years ago. And I was like, I didn't even know in the community. I didn't know about that community. And so it is a constant thing. And as long as, like, when you hear it, and you did great by saying, like, that hurts my heart, but you ask the questions, you're willing to listen, you're willing to learn. And that's something that's not always possible. I have another friend who her grandchildren, one, both have switched genders, and she doesn't know how to deal with it. And she's like, I know him as a boy, I know her as a girl. And she's like, I'm too old for this. And my thing was, like, I understand it is a hard change, but as long as you try, if they see that you try and that you care enough to try, that makes a huge difference in allowing them to know at least you care. You can give leeway of that. People sometimes are slower at learning. I have a friend who is transgender, and I knew him as Rachel for most of our life. And then he became Robbie. And I was like, I would slip up and go she, and then be like, ah. And he would give leeway because as long as you're trying, as long as you make the effort to understand, most of the community goes, okay, because we are all learning. We all have growth to do.
Yeah. You know,
go ahead.
I was going to say, I helped at Habitat for Humanity here years ago. And there was a person there who was a lead person in building. And originally he was a he, but was a she, kind of not surgically changed or anything like that, but colored his hair, grew it long, and I goofed up and I made a mistake, and I, because he was showing me how to do the windstorm things. But what was so sad was when it was time to go eat lunch, nobody invited him to go. You know, nobody invited him. And I thought that was a shame. So we went and had lunch, and he was wearing his skirt and had his purse, but he was a big brawny kind of a guy, looking like a woman too. So it confused people. So when we went to the restaurant, you know, we sat down, ate, and we had a wonderful time. But I just felt so bad about how these Christian men that we got all together, and I was in there because I wanted to learn carpentry, but how they behaved, you know, I didn't think that was right and not in line with Christian, being a Christian.
I have a friend that's an architectural professor in the UT system, and he took his kids to the store because they all wanted Power Rangers, and his younger son wouldn't take any Power Ranger except the pink one. And he said, oh my gosh, my son's gonna be gay. But he stuck with him, and he did become gay, but he stuck with him and accepted it all the way through. And then the poor kid died of a heroin overdose. But the father was so accepting of him. It was just a phenomenal thing. And he knew it from the second of that pink Power Ranger. But, you know, it didn't bother him. He said, I love my son.
Diane, I was going to share a similar story. So I've done some stage acting here in Dallas for a charity. And our stage manager happens to be somebody who goes by the name of Chrissy. But if you look at Chrissy, other than the fact that Chrissy has long hair and a ponytail, you wouldn't know any different, right? But Chrissy makes it clear right at the beginning, as you get to know the cast and crew, by the way, you refer to me as, if you, instead of, you know, if you want to say yes, sir, you say yes, ma'am to me. And my name is Chrissy, it's not Chris. And, but what I loved about Chrissy is Chrissy would just go with the flow, right? If somebody said, yes, sir, that would be yes, ma'am to you. And just kept going, that, you know, didn't even think twice about it. And Chrissy is very regimental about everything, right? And so somebody said, oh, don't upset him. And he heard it over the headset and he goes, you mean her, right? And we all chuckled because it's so easy to kind of just forget. The other thing I was going to bring up, which is, again, another cultural nuance, but something that I picked up early on when, you know, when I was here in America, was the fact that just about everywhere else in the world, it's absolutely okay for two males or three males to walk around with their arms on each other's shoulders, right? And I'll never forget, you know, I was married, my friend was married at the time, and Ranu and his wife were walking somewhere else, and both of us put our arms on each other's shoulders and we're walking, and all of a sudden one of our friends said, stop doing that, you're so gay. I said, no. I said, this is a cultural thing, you don't get it, right? But I see it, and I'll tell you just a funny thing, but just observe, because now you get to see a lot more of the immigrant population here in America, right? Look at like African communities, look at Eastern European communities, look at Indian communities where you see a lot of students or you see adult males walking in groups. It would not be unusual to see them walking with their arms on each other's shoulders, which is a culturally acceptable thing, right? But so you learn to sort of adapt, and it's like the Brits being told not to use the word fag for a cigarette, right? And yeah, it's because it has a negative connotation here. So anyway,
so
thank you. This was a good discussion.
It was.
I just put a link to Amazon if you're interested. It's Jim Dant is a, well, I think he's retired now, but he was a minister at First Baptist Church here in Greenville, South Carolina. And he wrote this, it's a very simple little book. It was written for the LGBTQ community, but I bought a copy, and it's very helpful, especially as a Christian who, I often hear people whose theology is much different than mine. And perhaps somebody who grew up in a more conservative theological tradition, where people tend to like throw out different Bible verses in defense of, or, you know, basically saying it's wrong. Jim addresses each one of those. He takes each scripture from the Bible that that people use as their reason for attacking people, which obviously there's no justification for that at all. But he breaks it down. He gives an educated explanation and translation of each of those. And the one that people always go to, Sodom and Gomorrah, and he explains that was a, that is a story of hospitality, and it goes into the culture of the Hebrew people, the culture, the times, and does that for each of these, even into Paul's letters where it's referenced. So it's kind of a nice, simple, handy guide, especially if you're in circles of people where they throw around that kind of thing. Well, the Bible says, well, Dr. Jim Damp has another take on that, that is also, you know, a educated position on that and how that should be translated in light of the culture and in light of other things that the Greek, the original Greek or the original Hebrew, and the words that were actually used, that somehow we get translated into English, and then we have what we have. So anyway, I liked it. Like I said, it's a very quick and easy read. So I put that there if that's helpful to anybody as well.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah.
The Kinks did a song, 70, 69, 70, 72, called Lola. Remember that, Tom?
Lola.
Yeah, and that's the first time that something like that ever came up in a song or in in pop culture. Yeah, I think that tune alone will break down a lot of walls.
Well, and I think I love that you mentioned breaking down walls, because I think part of my decision to do this series isn't to necessarily discuss, let alone bring somebody to a particular position on sexuality and gender in general as and faith. It's to me, it's all about love and how we treat each other. Mm-hmm. And we spent a great deal of time this year on kingdom. You've heard me use the term kingdom instead of kingdom. But through our Short Stories by Jesus series last spring, you know, a lot of the things that we have done over the last few months have really been about how do we, ecclesia, and we as individuals in our local communities, contribute to building God's kingdom on earth. And that comes about in how we respond to people, how we show unconditional love to people, and just the treatment of people, regardless of if the subject matter is something that you're dealing with on your own faith journey and how to reconcile that, or history in the 400 years of divisive history around African-American people in this country, whatever the issue is, at the end of the day, people of faith of all religions and all cultures would agree that it comes down to how we treat each other. And that's, you know, a huge part of building God's kingdom on earth and our role in that. And so, you know, this really hadn't occurred to me early on, but I met Melissa at a regional assembly here in Carolinas a few months ago, and she gave me this book, Colors of Hope. And I was like, oh, this, originally I thought it would start out being a daily inspiration for me to write those that I do. But then I was like, no, let's get these people on here. And because they all have different stories to tell and how these colors of the rainbow flag relate to them and their own faith journey stories. And so I hope you'll bring on other friends that you feel will be loved and get hope from this series as well, to invite them on. Because like I said, the next 2 weeks, we have guest speakers about this same subject. Then we have a few weeks of other things. And then in August, we have more people kind of coming back to other colors of this series. So it's going to be a good one.
Yeah, I think today went really well.
Mm-hmm. We hadn't had enough time to get the book, you know, in everybody's hands necessarily. And even when we have done that, not everybody who jumps on these Zooms has either seen the email in time or ordered the book in time. And so I just said, you can't count on that. Even if I had sent it out 2 weeks ago, we still right. have people joining this conversation that she would need to frame it in a way that they could be part of that conversation without having read the devotional book. But I do hope that to encourage people to get it And I haven't gone through with the questions, you know, the stretch, share, create, resist questions. But I'm going to do that myself. So I look forward to seeing what comes of that.
Yeah, she's an interesting person to talk to.
Rachel. Very much.
Did you want to keep recording?
We did.
Okay.
I felt like this part was still interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. Michelle, I just wanted to make sure.
Michelle, some of the inspirations you've sent this week really were wonderful. The one that started off with C.S. Lewis, that went right to me. And I appreciate some of your inspirations this week.
Thank you. Yeah, sometimes I have to do a series like that. I guess I can't stop recording now if we're changing the subject.